坐前面，你要坐前面啊，
没有
的。
直播
啊，
这边可以坐啊，
你可以坐第一个
正中间
好的，
还是我要让给你
Alright, so good afternoon everybody. It's my honor to introduce Dr. Bernard Bang, who will deliver the second talk in this series of MIS, the admissions organized by our National Center of Biological Sciences. And before we start with this lecture, I would like to give you a little bit of background on his career. Why we should be so honored to have him here. So, Roberto Bain attended the Brooklyn Technical High School in New York, and then went to Cornell for studies in physics and got a BS, Bachelor in Science from Cornell University in 1956, and his AM in Mathematics from Harvard in 1957. Then in Harvard he started his PhD under Julian Stringer. So Julian Stringer was the Nobel Prize winner for his contributions to quantum electrodynamics in 1965. And after completing his PhD, he went to Copenhagen for studies and became a professor of physics at the University of Illinois, where he has been since 1963. So Professor Bain began his career in physics at the time when more or less the basic understanding of, for instance, quantum theory had been established by the three people, including his doctoral advisor, Julian Stringer. And what was interesting about these developments in quantum theory is that essentially the people were at the time worried about collisions. So what happens if you take elementary particles and you scatter off each other? And at that time, when Professor Bain began his PhD, there was another interesting trend, which was to look at what happens with interacting matter at high energy. So I think this is probably, this subject was essentially the main theme of his research, where he has made very important contributions. In particular, in the early 60s, he pioneered the use of Green's functions, of non-equilibrium Green's functions, for the study of various kinds of non-equilibrium phenomena in quantum transport. And he wrote this, I think, very amazing book. Actually, the first time I came across Gordon's work was through this book. He wrote this book together with Leo Kananoff, where he really taught us that if you want to do non-equilibrium dynamics, you have to essentially do perturbation theory in complex time in this contour here, which is known nowadays as the Kananoff-Bain contour. Around that time in this community of interest in quantum fluids, essentially interacting matter at finite density, there was a lot of interest in the theories of Lefdan-Dau, which were motivated by experiments in helium-3. He developed this interesting fermi liquid theory, and it is in this context that Professor Bain made very important contributions to this subject. And he wrote also, actually, I think you will see he has written many textbooks. He wrote also a very good textbook on this subject, which I think now is the standard reference, together with Chris Bettig, with whom he has had a very long time collaboration. Chris Bettig is in Copenhagen at the Niels-Bohr Institute. And one of the things that, for instance, Gordon did, Professor Bain did, was to study, for instance, generalizations of this Landau fermi liquid theory to relativistic systems, which is something that is extremely relevant for nuclear matter, and particularly, you know, for neutron stars, as we will discuss today. Through my career, I have encountered, you know, Gordon's work in many instances, and one of them was, you know, at some point I was interested in superfluidity, and I came across this beautiful review where he describes superfluidity and essentially explains how one can characterize superfluids using correlation functions. And this was very important for my understanding and for my own research in the properties of helium for confining nanopores, finding this work. And he exactly a very interesting paper where he, for instance, studies the relationship between the BDC and superfluidity, which is non-trivial at all. The first time I met Gordon was actually, maybe he doesn't remember, in 2004 at a conference in Italy. And at that time, he was interested in vortex lattices. There were many interesting experiments being carried out by experimentalists in ultra-cold atoms in quantum physics, where they confine alkali atom gases, very dilute alkali gases in magnetic traps, and rotate them, and they can observe, they can take these beautiful pictures of vortex lattices. And one of the things that Gordon really contributed to and made very interesting observations is about the shear modes of these lattices, the so-called Kachenko modes. He showed that unlike shear modes in crystals, in other crystals, these shear modes will have a dispersion which is quadratic in momentum, and this has important implications, for instance, for the melting of this type of lattices. Of course, Gordon, as you probably can imagine, is an outstanding teacher. He has written many monographs on relatively advanced subjects, which actually provide the entry point for young researchers like me and other people when we were studying these subjects. But he also wrote a beautiful book, which collects a series of lectures on quantum mechanics, which I strongly recommend to students, because it's really nice and I think very accessible. Not at the elementary level, but once you have gone to the elementary level, it's a very interesting and very insightful reference. And probably this is not so well known, but Gordon has also a life as a historian of physics. He wrote a beautiful review article on the development of the electron theory in metals, where he, for instance, describes the role played by Hans Bethe, whom I think he knows very well. So, like him, Hans Bethe went from solid state physicist to nuclear physicist. I think he also made the same participation, so I think that puts him in a unique position to really describe this type of development as he did in this beautiful paper co-authored with two historians of physics. So, for his many contributions and in various subjects, of course, he was awarded many prizes. In particular, he was made a member of the National Academy of Sciences in 1982 for both physics and astronomy. He was awarded the Hans Bethe Prize for his contributions to nuclear physics in 2002, and for his contributions to ultra-cold gases, he was awarded the Ansager Prize together with Jason Ho and Chris Bentley in 2008, and more recently has been awarded the Kinder Award. And okay, so with this I would like to conclude, and I will remind you that this is a series of lectures, so next week actually we will have another colloquium in this series of lectures, which intends to celebrate the diversity of quantum metaphysics. It will be given by Professor Francisco Guinea from India and the University of Manchester, where he will be telling us about graphene and all the amazing developments that this incredible material has led to recent years. Without further ado, I leave you with Gordon and the golden era of neutron stars, a subject to which we all very much look forward to. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Miguel. Thank you very much for the lovely introduction. Two apologies. One is I hadn't realized this was a series in condensed matter physics, as I'm talking about neutron stars. However, one neutron star forms more condensed matter by itself than it will ever be studied in the entire history of mankind on Earth. And I just say, it's full of all the right things, lattices, superfluids, all the right concept. Second, if I start talking too fast, slow me down. Just raise your hands. And third, I have a tendency to forget the microphone. I go,
very interesting.
nobody will hear me. So if that happens, please warn me. Now, I also thank you for mentioning the
you got all the possible people. But the interesting story about the book of Leo Kadnov was Kadnov in vain. It's not alphabetical. Leo was a very smart guy. He said, when we write papers, why don't we alternate our names? And so we wrote one paper together, it was Bain Kadnov. Then we wrote the book that became Kadnov Bain. And that was all. Not all we ever wrote together. Then we make good friends. So what I want to talk about is what's going on in the interior of neutron stars. We sort of heard that story of combination of condensed matter. Of the interplay of condensed matter physics and nuclear physics and high energy physics and gravitational physics. In fact, all physics really comes into it, except string. Is this in the way?
It's okay.
I think there are two screens on the side, so you have to worry about that.
So to begin, here's a picture of a neutron star radius, something on the order of between 10 and 15 kilometers, as seen over New York City. It's not landing, don't worry. this is Manhattan over ABC Central Park. My high school is someplace just But this is a cross-section, cartoony, what goes on inside neutron stars. I want to tell you the story of what all the neutrons look like here. The typical masses are between about 1.4, that's twice the mass of the sun. The existence of very heavy neutron stars twice the mass of the sun is very important, because the big question comes, when you have that much mass together, how can you make matter strong enough to support it against gravity? Now, gravity is really, really strong. If you estimate when you drop something, it falls to sort of 980 something like this, centimeters squared per second. Centimeters per second per second. The surface gravity on Earth is a factor 10 to the 14th larger. Really good. If you take the mass of the sun and if you take the mass of the sun and a distance of 10 kilometers, you get a factor of 10 to the 14th compared to the Earth. That means that if you try to drop an object near a neutron star, just the tidal forces alone will break it apart if it's bigger than about this big. So if you were to drop a laptop, it would just come, even if it was a Macintosh, it would just come up like this. It also means that the binding energy of the particle on the surface of the neutron star is about 1/10 of its rest mass. It's a tremendous source of gravitational energy from any particle on the surface. Gravity is so strong we really cannot make a very high mountain on a neutron star. The typical mountain can be at most less than a millimeter high. That's a very lovely calculation to figure out. How do you determine what the highest mountain you can build on a in gravity? You have to know something about the breaking strength of solids. Now, on the outside, there's a very nice ordinary crust. Looks like the outer region looks just like an ordinary metal. As one goes further in, I'll explain, one has free neutrons coming available, and then the front region here called pasta nuclei, which I'll explain in detail later. Then one. Beyond this crust, which is about 1 kilometer across, there's the outer core where you have free neutrons and protons and electrons. And then the question is what goes on at higher densities. The trouble is we can't do experiments. We can measure what goes on there. And what I believe is what has a pretty close to continuous transition to a quark gluon plasma in the medium. I'll give you arguments. Go on. Okay. Now, neutron stars in the past couple of years have become very interesting, and why? And it's one much slowly through this. One is the fact that two solar mass neutron stars have been discovered. Second is we have now set up we've been flying on the spacecraft MISO, which I'll tell you in detail about, to actually measure neutron star masses in the radion directly. And then, of course, there was this fabulous event that took place in August 17th of last year, of the merger of two neutron stars and its emitting gravitational radiation. Okay, so let me begin by talking about the observations of high-mass neutron stars. First object is this thing called, they always tell them, pulsar J1614. What's interesting about this is that it's, one sees it essentially edge-on. It's in a binary orbit with a white dwarf. White dwarf is a mass of about half a solar mass, and neutron star is a mass just under two solar masses. For those who are not experts, and we will circle the top and set for the mass of the sun. And so, if you're looking at it, if this is the white dwarf, you see the orbit is edge on its way. That makes deducing the parameters of the system very easy. It's very easy to deduce the parameters. So the inclination is 89 degrees. So it's less than 1 degree off edge on. And so for a variety of measurements, including something called the Shapiro delay, which is the delay of light at its passage through a strong gravitational field, one can reduce the masses. So remember this number as two solar masses. Then there was a second high mass neutron star discovered a few years later. That was 2010, this is 2013. This has a mass of 2.01 solar mass, and again, in its companion is a white dwarf. And you see very beautiful oscillations of the phase, of the velocity, which is just what you showed, the Doppler shift of the signal from the neutron star. This is a very good emitter of gravitational radiation, and so if you were patient, you will see in something like 400 million years from now, the neutron star will coalesce with the neutron star, and LIGO will publish it. But in addition, there are many more stars that could be heavy mass neutron stars. These are things called the black widow pulsars. Black widow spiders are very big. How many people know what a black widow spider is? They eat their young. These are called black widow pulsars because they basically consume the mass of the companion star. And so they come in a range of something around less than 2, maybe as high as 2.7 solar masses. But this is showing the mass of the companion compared to the mass of the neutron star. The uncertainty here, however, is that unlike white dwarfs, these stars have dynamics inside. They're helium stars, and they get various oscillations. And that's really a good picture of the internal dynamics to be able to come out with a very accurate mass. I should mention that in the case of the other stars, this one, the fact that these are white dwarfs means that they sit there like rocks. They don't really affect the multiple fields. No coupling to internal modes that plays any role. Last June, a wonderful experiment was flown to the International Space Station. This is called MICER, and here it is. It stands for Neutron Star Interior Composition Explorer, NICER. It does very careful X-ray timing, but really on a nanosecond scale, with spectroscopy, the actual size of the box is like a large machine. There's very, very nice movies of it being launched at the space station. You see these orange. And what it wants to do is measure masses of radii of neutron stars, some 5%, by looking at the X-ray profiles emitted by known neutron stars. And it's been taking data. There are so far no very useful results. They will be punished. But the way it works is when one's measured mass is very, really very, very big. We know that since Einstein's theory of relativity, general relativity, as confirmed by the Eddington expedition in 1919, that light is bent by star. So if you think of light, it is an neutron star. Think of light coming from the left, it gets bent like this as it trips. Like this is exaggerated, but it'll be bent as it goes past the neutron star. What that means is light that comes from the back of the star, the observers over here looking this way, but you can actually see a little bit behind the star because of light. And so the amount you can see is measured by the angle you can see behind is a function of the mass and the radius. And in fact, by dimensions, it depends on the ratios of the mass to the radius. And so what one looks for is stars that have hot spots. And neutron stars should have hot spots if they're acting as pulsars. And you try to measure how long you see the hot spot, for what fraction of the rotational cycle you see the hot spot. And from that, you should be able to measure the ratio of the mass to the radius. Actually, what NICER is being set up to measure the amplitudes and phases, but in different colors and polarizations, it will yield a lot more information. So, stay tuned as results come available. Now, as I mentioned last August, there was a spectacular event, which was the merging of two neutron stars emitting gravitational radiation. This is a movie of... So here you see two neutron stars orbiting each other. This is not a real movie. It's an animation. The blue things are gravitational waves being emitted, and then suddenly there's that marvelous explosion here, forming something that was called a kilonova. And what you've just seen in this picture, and this in this big cloud here, of emitting X-rays, and when we stop. What you see in there, in that big white cloud, this is producing all the heavy elements. And it's believed that gold, all gold in the universe, most of the gold in the universe, is produced this way. So next time you look at a piece of gold, remember, it started, I think the gold atom started with the merger of two neutron stars. It's one of the most spectacular discoveries. Not only was it observed first by LIGO, the Gravitational Wave Observatory, and Virgo, the Gravitational Wave Observatory in Italy, Fermi, which is the gamma ray telescope, saw gamma rays. And gamma rays were seen, this is the usual bloop, heard the rising of the signal here, and then the gamma rays turned out just 1.7 seconds. Now this object is 130 million light years away. And the fact that it's 1.7 second difference tells you right away that both the gamma rays and the gravitational waves travel at speed of light. But if there was any difference, it was an enormous difference in the arrival of light. And then afterwards it was seen by many different electromagnetic observatories for 70, and from everything from X-rays over to optical to radio. Now the star is actually located in the constellation Hydra. It's actually it took place in the galaxy 44993, the southern hemisphere. And what you see here is this is the constellation. There's suddenly this spot that this is the optical pictures of the breakthrough neutron stars, and 4 years later it's become much bigger. That's incredible. This was some parameters measuring what the primary mass was of the two stars, subset between 1.36 and 1.6, the other star 1.7 and 1.36, solar masses. Now, it depends on how long this stimulus in the system is. Well, one really has a lot of very nice information about what's going on there. Modeling the merger is a very difficult problem. And I mentioned that one thing you see here is production of heavy elements, and what's called the R process. And the R process was well understood. How you make heavy elements, the rapid neutrino capture, the R stands for rapid.
Rapid neutron capture.
So if you capture neutrons, the only problem is nobody knew where it took place. They knew the details about how it had to happen, but the location was unknown. And this is really a beautiful confirmation of it taking place in the emergence of neutron stars. Okay. Now, let me turn to the main body of my talk, which is understanding what the internal structure of neutron stars is like. So what I'm trying to give you is an indication of why neutron stars are suddenly very interesting. The data coming in unexpected directions. And what we'll see here in this story is, one is understanding QCD, or understanding QCD has very much improved, and we really have some understanding of what they matter to turn into decomposed quark matter very, very high densities. And part of this has been spurred by the creation of quark gluon plasmas in ultra-relativistic heavy-ion collisions, as take place at Brookhaven and also at the LHC at CERN. And in addition, the cold atomic cold atoms studies have been very useful. What one sees Bose and BCS superfumes of cold atoms, and that's played a role in supplying interesting ideas to us. So let's start into the neutron star. As you march in, the basic key, why they call neutron stars, because of the Fermi energy, electron Fermi energy. As the system becomes denser, you get more electrons per cubic centimeter, and so the electron Fermi energy increases. As the electron Fermi energy is large, it pays for the electron to be captured on a proton, making a neutron and a neutrino. The neutrino, when this process takes place, the neutrino would leave the star. And so the basic process is that protons are converted into neutrons as one goes deeper into the star. Now, you say, well, why are these neutrons, why don't they just turn back into protons and electrons? Because in order to do so, the electron has to go into an unoccupied state. And if all the Fermi energy is filled up to a certain level, the electron Fermi C is filled up to a certain level, then this decay cannot take place. And so one has a chemical equilibrium, which is measured by the statement that the energy of the neutron at the top of its Fermi C must be equal to that of the proton at the top of its Fermi C plus that of the electron at the top of the electron Fermi C. So only the chemical equilibrium, proton plus electron chemical potential, must be that neutron. And so as you go deeper into the star, the electron chemical potentials get larger and larger. And so what happens is the kind of nuclear level that shifts. You begin with iron 56 in the outside. Iron 56 is the nucleus, it's the most tightly bound nucleus. It's the endpoint of thermonuclear. You know, in the stars, the sun burns hydrogen to form helium. Later, helium stars will burn helium to form carbon and other heavy elements, and the silicon and so on, and eventually to iron 56. And so what one finds in the outer regions is a sequence of iron 56, nickel 62, nickel 64. Then comes a sequence of 50 nuclei that involve 50 neutrons, selenium, selenium 84, uranium, so on, to iron 76. These are nuclei that don't exist on Earth at all because they're far too neutral rich. But they're held stably because of the electron, the very large electron sea that's around them. And then one goes to a sequence of nuclei first in the zone here, from molybdenum 120, strontium, molybdenum 124, strontium 120, strontium 90 is the usual atomic number, krypton 118. And then these are nuclei with 82 neutrons. And this is the standard predictions of what kind of elements one has. But behind this prediction, however, there's an assumption about the nuclear shell model. Namely, there are sequence of magic numbers for nuclei, 20, 20, 58, 50, 50, 82. But when nuclei become this neutron rich, are these really the correct shell closures? And there's a lot of interesting work going on at various, they used to call radioactive beam accelerators, or radioactivity is too scary. And so they're now called rare isotopic cell. There is the rare ion beam facility at Riken, and GSI in Germany, sorry, facility. In the US, there's some horrible name, facility for rare ion beams. And the Korean Society, which has a much marvelous acronym in Korea, which is the Korean Rare Isotopic Cell. In fact, if you look at recent experiments, they indicate that, in fact, there are variations in the shell structure beyond the standard matching numbers we know and love. You measure shell closure when it takes a lot of energy to remove to go to the next level, from the ground state. And so calcium is calcium. Calcium 48, calcium 40, and the shell structure's there. But the magnesium doesn't seem to have a shell structure at 28. Simply the silicon, sulfur, very weak, and argon also very weak. There's things going on there. Calcium was discovered actually have a new shell structure with the 34 neutrons present. So this is 28, so 34 is way out here. It's much more neutron rich. And so there really is the question of understanding the spin strip, the shell structure of the neutron-rich nuclei before we really understand what's going on for us. Now, if I can back up for a moment here, what happens beyond this? This last nucleus here, which would be krypton 118, if 82 neutrons is the current shell structure, all the neutron states in that nucleus are filled. And so the question, what happens if you want to make more neutrons? An electron gets captured, must captured by a proton. And what happens then is you begin to feel, as you make further neutrons, you begin to feel the neutron continuum states here. So if you think of the nucleus as a potential well, all the bound states become filled, and if you make more neutrons, they move into continuum states. So what happens is the entire solid becomes permeated not only with production of electrons from neutrons, but with a sea of neutrons, free neutrons as well. So, at high densities in the crust of the neutron star, one has a Fermi sea of neutrons as well. This phenomenon called neutron drift. They drift out of the nucleus. And the neutrons in between the nuclei are in chemical equilibrium with the neutrons inside the nucleus that is the same neutron chemical potential. Now, the protons appear not to be, all standard the protons indicate they stay together for down blocks. But eventually the nuclei merge together. As the density goes up, the nuclei gets closer and closer. Finally squeeze together in this form of nuclei. We point out something absolutely marvelous happens as well. These are the so-called busted nuclei. Normally one has nuclei, you think it's a nice round object. However, they have a large, they're charged, there's large Coulomb forces. And the Coulomb forces want to distort the nuclei in the same way that the Coulomb forces cause fission of the very heavy nuclei, like uranium, separate the two. And so the next structure one gets as the density increases is to form rods, which we call pulse beam. And then at higher density, instead of rods, we form sheets. And you go to still higher density, the sheets become thicker. So this is a set of lasagnas. Anti-lasagna, anti-spaghetti, finally, anti-meatballs. This is all very charming and funny. However, these structures are real, and over half the mass of the crust is in these structures over here. There's a lot of work that has to be done there. How do they emit neutrinos, for example? How do they contribute to pulling the neutron stars? This is not worked out in any detail whatsoever. Okay. Now let me turn to the material. So after this 1 kilometer crust, it comes to the material liquid, and this is where the nucleus becomes squeezed together. And then you will look as neutrons, protons, and electrons. And it's a very simple calculation. You should calculate equilibrium for free particles, and you find out, as you include some interactions, that the neutrons, about 95% of the particles are neutrons, 5% protons, and because these have charge, that's the 5% of electrons that balance electrical charge. Now, the both the neutrons and protons are non-relativistic, and they're most likely superfluids. The neutrons are formed neutral superfluid protons, charged superfluid, so it's a superfluid. The electrons are to remain perfectly normal. Transition temperature is about the Fermi temperature times e to the minus 137, this is e squared of h plus c. And that's a very small number. And so the electrons are moving normally, they're never touching. But they're fully relativistic. And the question is, what happens as you go further into the system? So there are many different exotic states in them, all the meson condensates. Very, very similar to those Einstein condensates. There's one says the laboratory, pion condensation, condensation A mesons, or pion droplets. There's still many problems in understanding those. For example, we don't really know when the crust becomes a liquid. It has a density of about 7/10 of nuclear matter density. Nuclear matter density is 0.16 particles per cubic meter Fermi. This is the density of nuclei inside a giant nucleus. But just quite where the transition occurs, it's uncertain about 10%. And I won't go into the technical reasons why it's uncertain. We've done a good enough calculations of nuclear matter in the presence of protons. Now, what goes on inside the nucleus? One way you can study this is you determine nuclei and nuclei scattering potentials. So you do scattering experiments. 300 MeV energy is sort of the limit where you just have two-body processes. Higher than that, you need to make five estimates. Well, this problem is completely solved. Every scattering experiment for 300 MeV has been done, and then what you try to do now is take potentials, generate nuclear potentials. And there are ones called the Paris Argonne National Laboratory, Nevada, two-body potentials. And so what you see, and then you feed in some information, Luteron, three-body nuclei, like helium, three, and hydrogen. And you then receive the Solomon-Schrödinger equation. Now, it used to be hard to solve the Schrödinger equation, but with large computers, you do it. And you solve the Schrödinger equation with two-body, you solve with many body parts, with these two-body potentials. And you find you get the wrong answer. That's bad. In fact, what you find, if you make a graph of energy, binding energy versus density, we know that nuclear matter should bind the green curve about a binding energy of about 16 MeV at nuclear matter density, this 0.16 particles per cubic meter. However, what you find for solving the Schrödinger equation, you find something out here. You get about the right binding energy, but the density is too large. That's very bad. This is what we're supposed to understand. What's going on here is that there must be things like three-body forces playing a role here that aren't counted just in terms of two-body potentials. In fact, if you look at the white nuclei, like helium-3, helium-4, hydrogen-3, helium-4, what you find is that if you construct models using just the 2-body potentials, you find the nuclei are not bouncing, they're not bound to helium-4, 28 energy binding energy experimentally, and 3 is 24 energy. So there's a good problem. And so what people have done is to make a 3-body potentials. So what you need to do here, what you need to do is sort of push the green curve to the red curve. It's how do you do that? You push it up over here. So it's supposed to be here. Pull it down over here. Red. That means the potentials, 3-body potentials must be repulsive at low density. Must be attracted at low density, but repulsive at high density. And so people write down various diagrams, processes that cannot be described simply in terms of 2 nuclei scattering. For example, this is a process where 2 nuclei export change of time meson from something called the delta, excited state of the nucleon back to time meson. These are intrinsic 3-by-3-by processes that involve the exciting internal states of the neutron. One doesn't know these at all, but people make the intelligent guesses. And so here, for example, is a standard equation of state done by my colleagues. You saw a picture of so this shows us energy per nucleon versus nuclear density. And the curve, the other thing you have to notice in this curve is going and the curves down here are without nuclear potentials, and the ones up here are with potentials. So they tend to make the matter much stiffer. Stiffer matter supports larger mass of neutron stars. So the 3-body force, which one doesn't know very well, begins to play a very low. And so here's the models of neutron stars that have been constructed using nucleons interacting via 2-body potentials plus phenomena of 3-body potentials. And how do you get this? What you do is you solve the equation of hydrostatic balance. This is called the Tolman-Oppenheimer-Volkoff equation. But it's really, it tells you how the pressure depends on gravity. If you look at the PDR, the derivative of pressure with respect to distance in the star, Newton's gravitational constant, the density divided by r squared, hold your hand over everything above c squared. This is just the ordinary equation of hydrostatic balance that tells you, for example, the properties of the atmosphere. And then you add a general relativistic correction. You know those terms about c squared is down below. So rho is the mass density, p is the pressure, m of r is the mass measured out to radius r. You don't need to know the details, but it's simply the first order equation you need to solve. And so you take the equation of state, so you calculate energy density as a function. This should be the rho. PowerPoint has a habit of changing the symbols all by itself. Things you don't want to use the symbol to put in, you get a different symbol. This is a row. This is the mass density, the energy density. The N is the baryon density, the pressure is just the derivative, the ordinary thermodynamic power of the energy of the particle. And so you plug this into the Tolman-Oppenheimer-Volkoff equation, you integrate the first order differential equation, you integrate from the center outward, and what you find, if you pick the central density, different equations of state, focus just on this curve, this one over here, you find as the central density increases, this is about 2.2 solar masses from the inside to outside. The message from this is there's a maximum mass neutron star. For any equation of state, there's a maximum mass. That is the neutron star. And so this gives it mass 2.2 solar masses. That's good, because that's consistent with the existence of the 2 solar mass neutron stars that have been observed. It's not consistent with 2.5, 2.6, the possible black widow masses. And this shows the radius, mass versus radius, and what you should look at this picture is goes from 8 to 13 kilometers. And so the radii here are in the range of 11 to 12. These will be measured better, will be measured better brought up by the master experiment. So just remember this nuclear, using nuclear work as a key point to solve this. It's a nice picture, but I think it's wrong. Why is it wrong? There's a limitation on how well you describe the way you say high densities, just in terms of interacting nucleons. Let me put the problem this way. Suppose you what's a bunch of this stupid guys, niobium. Suppose you could do perfect niobium atomic scattering. You learn everything there is about scattering niobium atoms from each other. Would you predict that metallic niobium is a super using just a scattering data? No. I mean, once you get to high enough densities where the internal structure, the nucleons become important, just free scattering data is not, it doesn't tell you the whole story. And so, one question, can you really describe the force of just sort of a static few body potentials? The time dependence certainly comes in. And what about higher, why some of 3-body, maybe 4-body, 5-body, 6-body, they become important. In fact, as the density increases, the higher, 3-body and higher become more and more important. And the characteristic density, every time you go add one higher force, the characteristic density of the same is about 0.4 particles per cubic meter. So it really is not a well-defined expansion of the system in terms of 2-body, 3-body, 4-body forces. But then you ask the question, can you even use acid-like particles to describe matter at high density? For example, suppose you were to fill a box with eggs, ordinary chicken eggs, and everything has scattered chicken eggs. Now, you keep putting more and more eggs, so you have 5 times the density of the most eggs you can put in the box. Would you still describe this in terms of ordinary chicken eggs? No. You've got chicken liquid. You have to worry about egg liquid instead. Well, the egg liquid is really important. So we have to worry about that. There are other problems here, which is this strangeness. The strange force may be an important hypothesis. And the other real question that I want to discuss is, even if you allow for quark matter inside the star, how can quark matter be stiff enough to allow to solve mass in our stars? Okay. Now, In a way, when we sort of run out of good theoretical ideas, so when we get to stars and observations, and I described some of these observations earlier, but I just want to continue with it. What can you learn? If you look at neutron observations, try to measure mass and radii of neutron stars. There is a program which I mentioned. In binary systems, which are what are called low mass X-ray binaries, where you have a neutron star in a close orbit with a more normal star. More normal star, the more normal star will dump mass onto the neutron star. The neutron star will undergo thermonuclear burning, and you see eventually the flashes. After the flashes, you try to determine the X-ray bursts. You try to determine what the mass versus radius is. And this project has been going on for a number of years, and one gets constraints on possible approaches. The best measurements will come from the NICER experiment. It's not really modeled. And of course, the gravitational waves are going to give us a lot of information. Other things that one can learn about are what are called glitches, so certain speed ups in the pulse repetition frequency. So pulsars are going on for a bit. And some of these have been observed to increase by one part, as much as 1.6. And that's telling a lot about what's going on inside the possible states of superfluidity inside the system. And there's also the circular cooling of neutron stars, where you measure the temperature of neutron stars versus time. Now, what you do is measure different families, different neutron stars, and plot them. This picture purposely is distinct. When you plot them, temperature versus age. And if you find neutron stars cooling especially rapidly, this tells you there must be exotic magnetic pulling mechanisms in some sense. That program has come to nothing so far. Now, more interesting question about the relation of equation state to masses. Suppose that you compare the neutron stars that you get using the soft equation of state as stiff equation of state. The soft equation of state, this is mass versus central density. The soft equation of state will come up like this, have maximum mass come down. So, and the stiff equation of state will be much higher when you're much lower density. So this is a maximum mass star for soft equation of state, the maximum mass star for stiff equation of state. What you see in this picture is that as the equation of state becomes stiffer, you get a higher maximum possible mass, but also at a lower central density. What it also means, though, is that once you have a measurement of a neutron star at a given mass, that if the mass that appears stiffer, then any equation of state below this, you're going to just throw out. You cannot possibly explain that star. And so what we know is that we have two solar mass stars here. That's actually the green curve, two solar mass stars. And that tells you that the equation of state must be pretty stiff. And the binary neutron star with that mass is about 1.4 solar masses, they're consistent with the soft equation of state. But these other objects I mentioned, the two stars with binary orbit of 1.4, 1.932.01, they require a very stiff equation of state. How do you get it with stiff equation of state? This is just a picture of the mass of the neutron stars that are known. Here's the mass, 0, 1, 2, 3 solar masses. And what you see, there are a lot of double neutron stars, like the ones that are together. Their masses are shown here. And they're all in the range about 1.3 to 1.4 solar masses. The Hulse-Taylor neutron stars here, these were the first observations that one really, that close-by neutron stars were emitting gravitational radiation. They got the Nobel Prize for that. Then the two neutron stars of white dwarfs are located. Interestingly, there seems to be, if you measure black holes, there seems to be a rather large gap between the mass of the neutron stars and black holes. This is 0.5, 10, 15 solar masses. And so the black holes seem to start around five solar masses, where neutron stars seem to go up to maybe 2. There's some objects with very large error bars that don't take the error seriously. Don't take the measurements seriously. This is a very beautiful picture of the everything's been learned from gravitational radiation. These are all the different objects. These, for example, are two black holes. This is that merge together in LIGO to form a black hole up here, another pair up here, and so on. And the recent measurement, this shows the mass up here versus nothing. And these are the two stars, these two here, that appear to merge together, the two neutron stars merge together to form this object. Now, it's in question, is this object a neutron star or a black hole? What was left over in that new neutron star merger? And we don't really know. It's probably a black hole. Actually, don't know. I mentioned that there was this program to measure mass and radiation neutron stars with the thermal burst of X-ray binaries, and with various batch of measurements, which I'm not going to use, you can get some correlation between the mass and the radii. And I'll just show you a lot of pictures. Here's some 8 different objects. There's some 12 objects which one has reasonable measurements. This shows a mass of around 1.6, the radius, something in the range of 10 kilometers. We put all these together. And what you find is that the equation state, in order to explain such objects, is stiff, but not quite as stiff as what I showed you earlier between interaction and neutrons. Now, let me talk a little bit about what matter looks like at higher density. This is a phase diagram I wrote down many years ago. 3 showing some phase of temperature versus density, carrier density. Now, in this matter of physics, all the other lectures in the series will be all in one pixel up here. That is not my focus. As you go, this nuclear matter density is here, nuclear inside, matter inside nuclei are here, neutron stars are sometimes there. But as you go up the density, as you heat matter tremendously or press it, one expects to find decombined quarks and gluons. This is the egg part. You squeeze the eggs and then matter turns into a little bit of eggs. Now here's a more modern version of the space-time. Which what one used to do fairly recently is that his temperature versus density variable density. The quarks are confined here. The nucleus made the quarks. And the quarks are confined. Out here at high density one has colored superconductors, quark matter that superconducting states. And then there's a transition here from hadrons, neutrons, protons, and such, to quarks out here. And what here now is quite marvelous. Between here and here, appeared from the last Monte Carlo calculation just to be a crossover. It was not really a base transition, a smooth crossover. And so the critical point of view, there was a large part of the circuit of this critical point, the heavy ion collisions at both at Brookhaven and CERN at the SPSs at CERN. They've not found anything so far. But this Monte Carlo calculation. So the pressure versus temperature, this is what you see in this picture, is that you just straight up the temperature axis at zero barrier density. And these curves are perfectly smooth as you go from very low temperature to very high temperature. There's no evidence in here of any phase transition whatsoever. It's really a very simple crossover. Now, you may say, well, in order to understand what's going on here, why don't we just do Monte Carlo calculations or lattice gauge theory everywhere? And the answer is you can't. Once you have finite baryon density, there's a thing called the sign problem, which is you do Monte Carlo calculations, but the weighting of any configuration becomes complex. Not in the sense of complicated, but in the sense of real plus American parts. And so the algorithms break down. What unsolved problem is how to do lattice gauge theory calculations and find a barrier density. So far we've really only done at basis and zero barrier density. Okay, so let's go back to this crossover because there's a very strange message. This is the crossover here. And what it means is you can go from down here to up here continuously. Now, we know that up here quarks have to be deconfined. And so quarks are deconfined here, even down here. We have deconfined quarks down here. We have a deconfined quark in this room. The answer is, well, how many people think you've got a deconfined quark in the room? How many people think you cannot have a deconfined quark? How many people have no opinion? Okay. The answer is no, you cannot have a deconfined quark. It just violates. And what the message says is that the matter up here does not have deconfined quarks, especially deconfined quarks. Rather, one has maybe large configurations with quarks can roam, but they are confined nonetheless. A few years ago, the quark matter meeting took place in Kobe, in Japan. Everyone's running enormous arguments about what's going on there. The finite matter to figure it out. And what it says is that the matter down here is the same, very similar matter up here. There are no free quarks running right either here or up there. And so what is the right picture? Here one has hadrons down here. Maybe the critical point, you can go around the critical point up here, the quark wall plasma up here, and this is all the same stuff. Exactly like a liquid gas phase transition. If you know the phase diagram of water, this pressure versus temperature, theories, his water over here, water vapor, is a critical point over here, which is at 373 degrees Celsius. And so one can go from water straight to water vapor, but it's very grounded without a phase change. And the same thing is true over here. You don't really need, this line may not exist at all, but you just go straight from hadronic to corpuscular plasma. What does change is that at low densities, there's a, one begins to get the super BCS pairing states, and you have those superfluid transitions, but then you have a different symmetry group. But up here, the symmetry group is basically the SU3 polar that's the one baryon, and that gets broken. I don't want to get into that kind of symmetry group. But one really has the same symmetry group that have nine phase and the four plasma phase. And so the matter may have just simply have two regions, one region up here, with one symmetry group and one region at the low density. So our current understanding is that the corpuscular plasma phase at high temperature is just a analytic continuation of the microphone. There's not a continuous phase. You don't cause a phase transition. You may cause a first order phase transition, as you do when you boil water to go to steam it. But in this way, you don't have to. Okay. Now let's go back to cold atmosphere. What is the best one? This is a picture of the temperature. If you take something like lithium gas, temperature versus one over the scattering limit, minus one over the scattering limit, which measures the strength of the interactions. So here one has very weak attraction between particles. Lithium 6 is a Fermi gas. Here one has very weak attraction. Here one has very weak repulsion. And what the phase diagram looks like is basically this. That as you, if you start the system is very hot, you cool it down, the three fermions, lithium, they're very hyperfine states, will undergo BCS pairing and form a superfluid. If you go up at this end of the game over here, what happens is the particle will form molecules, lithium molecules, and it's a residual action that leads to repulsion between the molecules. And what you find is just a Bose-Einstein condensate here of difermion molecules. And so there is a transition over here, BCS over here, BC over here. In fact, it completely continues. That was a very surprise. That one could go from a simple body of Cooper Street from pairing, from very weak repulsive interactions to with your BC condensation. Difermions, and that it's really the same physics all along. In fact, there's this region over here where the scattering length goes infinite, that's 1 over A goes to 0. And in this region over here, which is called the unitary region, there is, you just pass through this completely continuously. There's no phase transition. So it's a difficult, critical problem to calculate the properties of matter in this region. Okay. What I want to stress is, this picture begins to tell you a little bit what's going on inside nucleus as well. That you can have dipolars, that are very much like molecules, which go to BCS particles. That's a picture I want to use. That's a picture of matter. So here's a cartoon down here showing at this end of the day, in the BEC region, you have diatomic molecules. As you go to the intermediate region, you have the distance between the pairs. Becomes comparable to the size of the molecules, and then at the BCS region on this side, one has very large group of pairs, widely separated compared to the ether particle space. Okay, so the same picture again. And so the picture is as you go up in density, can one go from BC region to BCS? And so the picture that I'm pushing inside nuclear matter is that at low density, one has nucleons containing three quarks. As one neutron photons. But as you go up in density, the system separates and you begin to get a gas of dipoles, which are very much like the EC photons, by fermions. As you go up in density, the system separates and becomes more like more ECs.
Look at ECs.
And the question is, how continuous can this operation be? There's some evidence that it's fairly continuous. So this is sort of a more modern picture of the what the phase diagram looks like. There may be this transition over here. There should be a line over here demarcating a region where the superconducting states and quarks from ordinary non coherent matter out here. So now the question I want to come to is, can you have quark matter force inside neutron stars? What is the implication of all these pictures for neutron stars? Now, a long time ago, with Sui Chin, who I mentioned earlier, we wrote a paper which, unfortunately, I think set the field back very, very much. Our approach was adopted, I think, wrong. What we did then was propose that you look at the energy, how do you figure out the force in the inside? Well, you write down an equation of state, nuclear matter, like this red curve over here. Then you write down your favorite quark equation statements, and they cross it somehow. And being good thermodynamicists, we said, you must make a Maxwell construction. You sort of draw a straight line of the tangent for the curves over here. It's a Maxwell construction. And then what you just go is you go from here up to here as nucleons, and you simply jump up here to quarks. So you may have some small amount of quarks in the center. And so the standard picture until very recently has been that you may have a small quark core inside a neutron star, which mostly made of nucleons. Now this picture's wrong. Why is this picture wrong? Come back to eggs. So you want to compare the equation state of eggs at 10 times normal egg density, as it puts back these eggs, compared to the inflation state of liquid egg matter. And so, at these very high densities, there is no hadronic equation of state, because these very high densities don't have hadrons. So it doesn't make any sense to have hadronic equation of state particles this big at two spaces. But the other thing about this is this picture will only allow quark matter equations of state that lie below the hadronic state. So if you have quark matter equations of state, it's much stiffer. You say, I'm not interested in that, because that can never cross the hadronic equations. So the bottom line is, by comparing hadronic equations of state with quark equations of state at high density, you miss out on the possibility of having stiff quark equations of state. So let me show you the main 3.5 hours. He said I can go on as long as I want. Attention is just excellent. Let me show you how one implements this. I'm going to show you calculations done in what's called the Nambu Jonglo Senior Model, whose details you don't have to know. You have to know only two features of it. Namely, it allows for its basic ordinary BCS pair. And this is just the attractive interaction between pairs of quarks. And it's governed by a strength H. Just remember H. H from CQ. And then it's also possible a short range repulsion between the quarks, just like the contact interaction between the atoms. And that's governed by a couple of Nusselt G. And calculation will show you with the up-down strange quarks as well. Now, what do we know? Thermodynamics again. The nicest thermodynamic variable for studying equations of state are to look at the pressure versus the chemical potential. The pressure must be smoothly never decreasing function. You can't go up and then back down. But that violates the dynamics, I'll show you. And it's gotta be continuous. It doesn't have to be differential with, but it has to be continuous. So what we know, for example, in the low density, we believe the nuclear matter goes to the same. Maybe up to twice the density of matter itself. And nuclear. So here's the nuclear equation state. Up here, we can write down there's a model of quark equation state. But then what we know is that the real equation state had better join these two somehow. So, I'll show you the interpretation. Oops. This is slightly out of the way. Here's an interpolation. So the final picture has to be some interpolation. Nuclear down here and quarks up here. And even though we can't calculate these intermediate regimes over here, the constraint, the joins are really very tightly constrained. That was an interesting story. So let me back up a little bit here. First of all, the question, can you get large mass neutron stars? What you need for large mass neutron stars is the equation state has to be very stiff. You try to squeeze it very hard. It's a stiff equation, a soft equation. And how in a picture of pressure versus chemical potential can you tell whether the equation state is soft or stiff? If you're good at thermodynamics, you know exactly what to do, but nobody does. The equation state that's stiff for a given mass density has a higher pressure. So the green curve is stiffer than the red curve. It's soft, stiff. Now you can read this picture the other way. If it says here that the stiff equation state will, at a given pressure, will have a lower mass density than the soft equation state. So low mass density given pressure means stiffness. Keep that in mind. It's all sorts of pressures. If you now do take the pressure of some potential and you just go to the tangent of it, then because the energy is the chemical potential times the density times the pressure, and the slope here is the density rather than density, the intercept down here, this distance, is just minus the energy. So what it says is that this is a stiff equation state, this is a soft equation. Soft equations, stiff equations have a low energy density and pressure. And soft equations have a large energy density and pressure. So you just got to look at the slope. So the flatter it is, the stiffer the equation is. Okay. I discussed this before. So here's a simple interpolation. Now, if you take a minimal model with no repulsive interaction between quarks, what you find is this equation state, which is fairly vertical, means it's very soft, is not stiff enough to support high mass neutron stars. Now at this stage, we don't have adequate control over the quark matter, so I'm just going to drop this GD as a parameter. And try to fit between stars. Well, if you increase GD, what happens? It's very simple. The equation state actually moves over here. It moves soft, but it's stiffer, because the slope here is less than over here. This is stiff. What's good? What it isn't? Because what happens over here is you see there's an inflection point. If you try to interpolate between nuclear matter over here and the quarks over here, you can't quite do a nice curve without bending back. The inflection points are not good, because what it says in this region over here, the second derivative must turn the pressure with respect to chemical potential turns negative. The first derivative of the pressure with respect to chemical potential is just the density. So the second is the derivative of the density with respect to chemical potential. If that's negative, that means the matter is unstable. So you're never allowed to have inflection point state. So if you just take a large repulsive interaction between the quarks, alone, that will make matter less silly than that. What can we do about that? Well, Homer Simpson tells you. Do people watch The Simpsons? Probably in Mandarin. So, what can you do? Let's come back to the dipole pair. It turns out, if you increase the strength of the this pair, you get the pairing gaps much larger. This tends to shift the equation, say, here over here. And so, for reasonable pairing, it moves like this. So, for reasonable strength of pairing, G is a whole little couple of constants. And now you're joining a senior model. You can get equations of shape that match nicely in the new equations. You can do interpolation. So, the basic message is that there's enough room within phenomenological models of high density quark matter to be able to join the nuclear equations at low density and express high mass nuclear stars. Let me show you the results. We call this stuff an equation of state, which is actually Kesar Sudarai, Tokyo, Joe Kojo, who's now Newman, as students. We call the equation of state HQC, QHC, that's quark hadron cross of 18, so we can issue a new version every year. So we update the number. And this is pressure versus chemical potential for equation of state. This shows pressure versus chemical potential for pressure versus density. What's interesting here, I want to show you, is you see this yellow blob and green blob over here. These are using data from the low mass X-ray binaries to try three equations, different mass radius relations that emerge from the trying to measure mass radius relations in X-ray binaries. And the equation of state that we're coming out with are really quite consistent with what we're saying. Once we have nicer data, and I mean that in both senses, they're nicer, one from the experiment, one that more accurate, then we'll be able to get more, be able to tune the equation of state somehow. So, but the basic take home message is we can really make neutron stars. Neutron stars, they get up above two solar masses, which we're aiming for at the moment. There's enough parameters in the game by changing the pairing and the compulsion between quarks to get higher. But at the moment, we're able to explain two solar mass neutron stars with the ordinary quark, with fairly repulsive quark matter, but with a large BCS pair as well. And what's nice about needing a large BCS pair is if you think at high densities or down density, the quarks want to combine into pairs and eventually want to combine into triplets in the ordinary hadrons. So you really expect fairly strong pairing correlations to take place in the quarks. This is some rather indirect evidence that things like that are happening. Okay. Well, just to sum up, what we've learned is that below two solar, twice nuclear matter density, this nuclear equation staying higher density, above higher density, quark matter equation staying. And the matter in between is something in between, right? No idea what it is. That's really a wonderful unsolved problem. How do you get from nuclear matter to quarks? Continues to somehow. You want to write down simple models. I have no idea how to do that. But it's really quite well constrained. By having to fit between hadron and quark matter and be able to spend two solar masses. So the quark model equations of state that emerge are really kind of stiffer than what we thought previously. And that was just a mistake of throwing out the stiff equations of state. The problem is by no means done. The nuclear matter equation of state has reasonable uncertainties because nobody really has done complete calculations from neutrons and protons together. The interpolation between nuclear matter equation state and quark matter equation state, that leads to errors as well. The couple of pairing forces are uncertain as one first principles handle on them. how do you go beyond the NJL model, or if at some point we have Monte Carlo, quantum chromodynamics Monte Carlo calculations, that would be kind of nice. The question of the maximum mass neutron star is still unknown. I don't know where the gravity raised the depth of last summer of merging neutron stars gave rise to a black hole. And another interesting question is, can we begin to describe, do we have enough detail to describe the merging of neutron stars, the input to the microscopic physics? And there, the matter, as the neutron stars begin to merge, the matter gets hotter and hotter, and one needs really something between temperatures on more than maybe 100 everyday temperatures. So we need not only cold nuclear matter, cold quark matter, but we need to hot nuclear matter. That's a problem. And there are all kinds of cooling and transport problems in neutron stars that still need to be worked out. And I just want to mention one last thing. That one thing we've learned from binary neutron stars is that there's a lot of room for much more experimental. One is, what we really need to understand the role of strangers in the IGS. I didn't discuss the question of hyperactivity. Sigmas and lambdas of particles get mixed in the nucleonic equations. The calculations what we've done so far include up-down strange quarks in the quark matter. So we really need much better experiments here. These will be done in facilities at FAIR and GSI in Germany this fall. But in addition to understanding our process much better, this making a gold in the universe, one really needs to have much better real isotope facilities, very high intensity. So a lot of the R process details need to be worked out much better. So I think what I want to close with is just to fill in, neutron stars are really entering this golden age. And I think the word golden represents golden clutches. But we're getting tremendous new data, gravity waves, ICs and such, massive neutron stars. Plus, tremendous improvement in our theoretical understanding, which has come from many different directions, from what's going on inside the matter. So I think over the next 10 years or so, I do expect we'll learn a tremendous amount more about the neutron stars. So thank you. And the kinesthetic properties of the neutron stars. So thank you. I don't know how to make neutrons have densities. A neutron gas has densities which are very large compared to when the neutrons are much closer to them than their radius. The egg problem.
Maybe we have questions from our senior people. Yeah.
I have a question.
Yeah.
Okay. So you mentioned about neutron science is a fantastic system to study quantum metaphysics as well as astrophysics. I wonder if in the core of a neutron star, it must be the gravity must be so strong. So would quantum field theory in curved space-time effect also an important
thing? That's a very good important question.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. It's really a question of length scales. I mean, the characters in length scales for gravitational physics is meters. This is a percent change. However, the microscopic physics determined by the different space are fairly. The actual curve of the space is curved over the space. And so the game is always you calculate in the local 3D form of the right square, which means you do the calculation together around it. That's but of course, calculators need
any more questions?
I have a question about the merger binary neutron star. So, well, this is, father and out of equilibrium kind of very out of equilibrium. So, if one was going to try to simulate these co-atoms, something you are also interested in, right? I guess one of the observations that you made is the fact that the mother gets hotter in this process, like the mother gets. This is something that is hard to see, sort of like.
So I really don't know how we'll go about this.
So how this would happen? You say that the inner core of the nucleus is a superfluid. So sort of eventually it would have like two blobs of superfluid coming together.
When you say nucleus starts to move, the tremendous amount of gravitational energy is released.
That's going to be the story. So for that, we need more knowledge beyond the question of state. It's a bit like.
Well, you need state, you need transport coefficients.
Yes.
But again, because the wind scales are large compared to the space, ordinary.
This is a big part of the next. It's hard to say that. So how about the rotating universe stars? This is going to be very different from the whole
thing. That's an interesting question. You basically, people know how to write down the gravitational metric of the next star, but neutron stars increase in frequency. It gets more and more complicated. And one really needs to do a lot more in NICER. If you see a NICER experiment, you really have to analyze whether it's whether higher or relativistic experiments. You need to know much more about the stars except the mass radius. Two neutrons are supposed to be most. A neutron star, and logic.
So, but I guess there will be also vortices.
Oh, there are lots of vortices. I'll talk about vortices. Vortices. And those go through the same
configuration. Yeah.
Just one question. So this equation of state allows for the, it explains the, there being the black widow neutron star.
Maybe.
It depends on the mass. It accounts for the mass.
Mm-hmm.
It accounts, so this just accounts for the...
Well, we'll come with free handles with the term. But at some point you say, you really believe it. Like, you know, this is probably not the final word of what's that. But we run this more as showing what existed with how quote our mechanics are. I really do not know what the maximum mass is. I wrote a paper about it many years ago, said, suppose you believe the equation states up to CS, and then you continue it beyond that with the maximum, the stiffest matter you can have, and the stiffest matter is matter in which the sound velocity is equal to the speed of light. Now, if it's stiffer than that, the sound velocity is greater than the speed of light, and people tend not to have it. For obvious reasons. And there, if you go up to 2.2, if you believe in what's going on inside neutron stars, it's twice the matter is, and there are very few to do, then the maximum mass is about 2.9. If you believe it up to 4 times the amount of mass, maximum mass drops to 2.2. I would tend to be surprised if the neutron star had not done mass of 27. It could be. The amount of mass is 3 something, perhaps.
Thank you.
Yeah. Excuse me, another question.
Good.
When you're detecting the gravitational wave, gravitational wave. The first case is two black hole merging.
Yeah.
And here you talk about two neutron star merging. What's the significant difference between two cases when you observe the signal? The main difference between two cases. The one case, first case is two black hole merging, and here you talk about nuclear. Does it make any difference when we talk about
two black holes are rather fast. If you remember the sound.
Yeah. And
this one builds up in a much longer time scale. That's one difference. But the trouble is, the LIGO detectors were not really capable of going much beyond 500 kilohertz.
Mm-hmm.
That's our system. You don't really have very short time. Short time resolution.
I understand because in neutron star, in your video, it has an explosion, right? But in black hole, we don't have this.
No, that's right. Because when black holes work, everything just goes basically dead. This doesn't come out. Everything goes down. But there is certainly in the first event there were at least 3 solar masses that just went into radiation.
Oh.
But there are charged particles around here, also. So in a sense, the neutron star mergers are much richer. Now, there's a whole other class that has been which is neutron star and black hole. would be like black widow, black hole. So to eat the neutron star. But if the neutron star is a black hole,
more comfortable in mass, that becomes a more interesting event. But stay tuned. I'm sure it will happen.
Thank you.
Also affect the magnetic field surrounding the surface of the neutron star? A magnetic field surrounding the neutron star?
Yes. I didn't talk about the magnetic field, most of ignorance. But again, at high densities, the magnetic field is not very good because the energy density is small compared to all the other energy. But at lower densities, in the outer regions of the crust, magnetic field can play roles. Now, the role of magnetic fields is very interesting. Because there, you saw it at the end, it's killing all the jets coming out. And those are really caused by the rotational energy winding up the magnetic field. And the fact you see jets means that rotational energy has been converted into magnetic energy. And probably you're not left with it. So I'm probably not.
Just out of curiosity, is there any understanding of how the rotational energy is converted into electromagnetic energy?
Yes, but beyond my pay scale.
Yes, we see. So since there will be another meeting tomorrow, if there are no more questions, I think we can end here. Thank you. Professor Lane for his time and a nice talk. Okay, thank you very much.